One of the things that was part of Paul's message was that outward circumcision is not the outward mark that you are God's people. Because the fact is, one can be outwardly circumcised and not be inwardly circumcised. And this is a concern that we really find in a number of places in the Old Testament. That this wasn't a New Testament idea. That as far back as the book of Deuteronomy, we see God concerned with this. And in fact, in Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 16, Moses says this to the people. He says, "So circumcise your hearts and stiffen your necks no longer." And so from very early on, from the fifth book of the Bible, we have this idea that it was more important to have a circumcised heart, to have a heart that is willing to be led by God, than to just have the outward work of circumcision. And so when you get to Galatians in chapter 5, Paul goes so far as to say, "Behold, I, Paul, say to you that if you receive circumcision, Christ will be of no benefit to you." And then he goes on to say, because if you start trying to fulfill all of the works of the law and looking for all of the outward marks of the law, then you'll have to do everything that's in the law and you can't do it. And so Paul is very clear that circumcision is not and does not have the kind of power that what these Jewish Christians were wanting to give it. And in fact, it never did have that power. It was simply an outward mark that they were part of God's people. But it was never meant to be the end all. And so again, not only do we see it in Deuteronomy, but we also see it in the book of Jeremiah. In Jeremiah chapter 4, verse 4, he writes and he says this, "Circumcise yourselves to the Lord and remove the foreskins of your heart." And then he encourages them to be led by Christ. So, as a Christian, there's a question that we have to face, okay? And this is a question I've been kind of reflecting on all week. And it's this. What makes a Christian? What is a Christian? One of the reasons I started thinking about this question is because I was in a conversation on that glorious and wonderful godly institution, Facebook. And in this conversation, I got into a conversation with this man and about what is a Christian. And he was saying that his belief was that a Christian was one who follows the teachings of Christ. And if you look in some dictionaries, it certainly does give that definition. But, you know, my response was an atheist or someone who believes the teachings of Christ is what he said. But my feeling is an atheist could believe the teachings of Christ and yet not follow Christ. And it's more to be a Christian than just believing some teachings that Jesus had. I mean, Jesus had a lot of ethical teachings that anybody could agree on. And say, yeah, I believe, but that doesn't make them a Christian. And so this question has been sort of one that I've been kind of meditating on and thinking about. What makes a Christian? And so I went into the Bible. I started looking for all of the places where someone asked the question, what must I do to be saved? Or something along those lines. You know, some kind of a variant of that question. What do I have to do in order to be a Christian? And I've come up with a couple of different verses that I want to read you. The first one is in Acts chapter 2. Well-known passage. This is at Pentecost. Peter has just preached his first Christian sermon. Actually, the first Christian sermon. And on the other side of the Jesus' resurrection. And he gets to the very end of it. And it says that the people's hearts were cut to the quick. And they cry out and they ask, "What should we do?" And this is what Peter says. Acts chapter 2, verse 37. Peter said to them, "Repent, and each one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, for the promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call to himself." So there's our first answer. Repent and be baptized, Peter says. Now, a little bit later, if you keep reading in Acts, you'll get to Acts chapter 16, verse 31. And this, again, is a very well-known story. The story of Paul and Silas being put in the jail at Philippi. And while they're there in the middle of the night, they're praying and they're singing hymns of praise to God. And there's an earthquake and all of the jail doors open. And the Philippian jailer jumps up and he goes and he sees that the doors are opened and he thinks, surely I am going to die because these men who were in my charge have escaped. And just as he's about to kill himself, Paul cries out and stops him. And the Philippian jailer asks the question again, what must I do to be saved? And this is what Paul answers in Acts chapter 16, verse 31. Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your household. So there's our second answer. Now, if we continue reading in the New Testament, we'll get to Romans chapter 10. And again, we have Paul discussing how a person reaches salvation. And this is what he says in Romans 10, verses 9 and 10. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart a person believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth he confesses, resulting in salvation. And so as we look at these passages that are specifically addressed at how does a person enter into the kingdom of God and become a Christian? These are the things that we come up with. There are four: repentance, baptism, belief or faith, and confess that Jesus is Lord. And so when a person's life is characterized by repentance and by faith and by confession, he is living a Christian life. Period. Now, this hasn't satisfied a lot of people. When you look at the 2,000 years of Christian history that have passed since Jesus was raised, almost 2,000 years, what you will find is that Christians have constantly been looking for things to add to that list. What they have done is they've done the same thing that those Judaizing Christians did in the first century. They've looked for a circumcision, an outward act, an outward thing that would delineate somebody as a Christian, something that would be easy to see, something that would be easy to note, something that wouldn't take me, it wouldn't take me getting to know the person. It would just be as simple as giving them a glance and saying, yes, they're a Christian. No, they're not. It's easy that way, right? I mean, that's what the circumcision was about. And that's what people have been doing for 2,000 years, looking for things to be able to say, yes, he is, no, he isn't. And so they have given this power to all sorts of things over the past 2,000 years. For instance, people give it to theologies and doctrines. And they have said, okay, if somebody is a Calvinist, then that means that they're really saved. Or if somebody is an Arminian, that means that they are really saved. That's just not true. Jesus didn't say, Peter didn't say, Paul didn't say, repent and believe and confess and subscribe to these 5 points of doctrine. It's not what he said. He said, repent and believe, confess, be baptized. But people try and add these doctrines, add their theologies and say, well, if you really want to please God, then you'll not just do that stuff, but you'll also believe just like I do. People have done it with where they worship. You know, there are some people who feel like you got to worship in a sanctuary building like this. There are others who feel like, no, that's not the real holy people. If you really want to be holy, then you'll worship in a home. And there's been this argument, you can see it throughout history, of people arguing about where is the proper place to worship. Why do they do that? They do it because it makes things easy. Because then I can say, well, you know, everybody that's in this room, we're Christians. But all those people that are worshiping in houses or wherever, they're not. And that's how we know the difference, because we're here and they're not here. But that's not what Peter or Paul or Jesus said. That's just something that we have tried to add. The same thing could be said for all kinds of things. I mentioned in Sunday school this morning that one of the things that the early Church of God reformers were concerned about was this very fact. They were concerned with people who had a membership in a church. And so they thought, well, this is my mark that I'm a Christian, that I'm a believer, because I've got my letter that I go to the Baptist church, or I go to the Methodist church, or I go to the Presbyterian church, or wherever I happen to go. And the early Church of God reformers were concerned about that, because their whole message was, no, that is not what makes you a Christian. That's not the mark. The mark is, well, we'll get to that. But do you see what's taking place? They're looking for something that makes it easy. And Christians are not called to just look at this outward thing and say, yes, they're a Christian. No, they're not. Now, here's the problem, is that the Church of God Reformers, they understood that at the beginning. But as time went on, they got involved in the exact same stuff. You know that? And that's why they started saying, oh, Brother Haas, you don't have a tie on, so you're in. But I got a tie on, so I'm not in. Or I'm wearing the tie, so I'm in. He's not showing enough respect for God, so he's not in. What is that? It's looking for an outward sign that I can real quick say, well, they're a Christian and they're not. We see the same thing. There have been groups that have said, you got to have a beard. There have been other groups that have said, you can't have a beard. What's the point? Why is it such a big deal? Because they want it to be easy to say this person's a Christian and that one's not. You could say the same thing about just all kinds of issues. And you know them all. We could go on and on and on looking at all of the ways that people have tried to add things to the faith and said, well, not only do you have to believe and confess and have faith and do these things and repent, but you also have to dress like me, think like me, be like me. Because I'm right. And I'm pleasing God more than everybody else. So if you want to really please God, you'll just do just what I'm doing. What's the problem with all of that? They aren't scriptural. That's a problem. Got news for you. I've read this whole thing. There is not a single word about ties. Not a single word. Neither bow ties nor neckties. There's not a word. There's not a word about Arminianism. There's not a word about Calvinism. Not a word. All of those things, all of those external things, people have put on the scriptures, but they have not gotten them out of the scriptures. Paul, like I said, did not say, if you confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, believe God raised him from the dead, and don't have a beard, you shall be saved. Now, why does this all matter? None of these things are the markers that someone is part of the family of God. I kind of wish at times they would be. I kind of wish there was something easy external that I could just say, you know what, every Christian, this is what we're going to do. You know, we're all going to wear, I don't know, whatever it is. We're all going to wear purple. And that means you're a Christian. You will always wear purple. Purple's the only color you can wear. That really cuts out most of us, doesn't it? I think we have one saved person in the church. Wouldn't that be easy? That would make it so simple. Unfortunately, that's not the way that it works. It's just not. That's not how God's people function. It's not how the church functions. The fact is that God's people consists of people, as Brother Tony said this morning, who don't all think exactly alike or act exactly alike or dress exactly alike or are convicted exactly alike. And yet he desires for us to have unity, as Brother Tony talked about this morning, but also to have a witness into the world. Now, I want to look at the same kind of idea that we talked about this morning, but look at it in a little bit of a different way. If none of those things mark a person as part of the family of God, what marks a person as part of the family of God? Faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. Love is what marks us as part of the family of God. And I believe that when you go into Revelation, there's all kinds of people that they go to Revelation and they read about the mark of the beast and the mark that God puts on them, and they come up with all kinds of fun and exciting things. I believe that when Revelation talks about the mark of God that is on a person, it's, you know, I read a book by Uriah Smith this year. He was a Seventh-day Adventist who wrote a commentary on Revelation. And in it, you know what he says the mark of the beast is and the mark of God is? He's a Seventh-day Adventist. That might give you a clue. The mark of the beast is Sunday worship. And the mark of God is Saturday worship. That's crazy. You know what the mark is? The mark of God is the faith, the hope, and the love that a person has only by means of salvation. And you know what the mark of the beast is? It's all of the opposite. It's the self. It's the hate. It's the lack of, it's the desperation. It is the lack of faith. It is the opposite of what God has given us that mark us as his people. And it is love that most of all marks us as the people of God. In John 13, 35, every one of us here probably knows this verse. What does Jesus say? By this all men will know that you are my disciples. By the length of your beard. By your haircut. By the clothing that you wear. No. By the love that you have for one another. That is the mark that a person bears in their life that testifies that they are truly part of the people of God. Now let us for a moment allow this to sink in and let us think about this, that people know we are Christ's disciples by the love that we have for one another. Do you know what that means? That our greatest witness is the love that we have for one another. Because Jesus says that's the way people are going to know. In other words, I can go out and I can preach and I can tell people about all the things of God. I can tell them about the Bible. I can tell them about sin. I can tell them about repentance. But if I don't have the love of God shed abroad in my hearts, and if I am not living in that love, then my message is worthless. Because they're not going to believe that I'm truly one of Jesus' disciples. And so our love for one another, our love for our brothers and our sisters is our greatest witness. And if we want to be soul winners, as again, Brother Tony talked about a few weeks ago, if we want to be soul winners, you know what the very first step is? Love one another. Because that is how people will see that there is something different in the life of a Christian. Love is our greatest witness. So, if that is true, then when we neglect to show love, we are harming our witness for Christ. We are harming our ability to tell others about him, because our lives are testifying against the words that we say. Oh, if I preach about the love of God and how much God loves us and how God's love just empowers us to love others, but then I get enraged when someone cuts me off on the way to work, what does that testify about the love of God in my heart? Not too good. If I tell about how great God's love is, but then I don't have enough love in my heart to tip a decent amount of money to my waiter, what does that tell that person about the love of God? That it's not worth a whole lot. Our love for one another, our love for God and our love for our fellow man is the greatest witness that we have, because genuine, holy Christian love is what separates us from the world. It's what separates us from every other religion. It is what separates us. It is what marks us as God's people. And so again, we have this tendency as human beings to want to use all of these outward marks to get this minutia and try and find these little things that we can say, this makes you really a follower of God. And what Christ is saying to us is, no, it is my love that marks you as one of my disciples and as one of my people. That's how we need to witness. Love is the thing that marks us. And so if we want the mark of God on our foreheads and on our hands, we ought not go looking out there for something. We ought to seek the love of God. And if we are wary of a mark of the beast, don't go looking for a microchip. Don't go looking for some doctrine or a belief, because the mark of the beast is the idolatry of the heart. It is the hate. It is all of the selfishness and sinfulness that comes out of the heart of a man who has not been changed and transformed by the love of God. That's where it comes from. So we're led to this important question. This is a very important question. And it's something that Brother Tony talked about this morning. But again, I want to look at it from a little bit of a different angle. And it's this question, what is love? Because in our culture, you know, there's all kinds of different ways people could define love and talk about love. And, you know, we love all kinds of things. I love pizza. I love my wife. I love my daughter. I love my father and mother. I love them all in different ways, right? I love them all. I love books. I mean, there's lots of things that I would say that I love. But what is Christian love? What is holy love? What is the kind of love that God is calling us to have? Because that kind of love is not a natural thing. I can naturally love books. I do. I mean, it's something that I wasn't a Christian and I love to read and I love to buy books. That was a natural thing. But the love, the holy love of God is something that does not take place naturally. It is something that is from God. It's something that takes place because we've been transformed. So what is love? Well, Paul does a wonderful job of describing what love is in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And in fact, if you read verses 4 through 7, which we're about to look at here in a moment, if you read these verses, what you will find is that Paul is dealing with all of the things that the Corinthians are not. And we're going to look at how, when he mentions things, he's already mentioned them in the letter prior. You know, they're boastful. He talks about their boasting, and then later on he says, look, love's not boastful. He talks about how they're proud, then later on he says, love's not proud. He talks about how they're doing all of these things, and then when he gets to 1 Corinthians 13, he says, love's not like that, and he's calling them to begin loving. Not only because loving is the only thing that will give us any kind of a Christian unity, but also because loving is what testifies to the power of God in our lives, and it is our greatest witness. So, how does he describe love? Well, we read it already, but we're going to read it again. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, just going to read verses 4 through 7. This is what he says. Love is patient. Love is kind. It is not jealous. Love does not brag and is not arrogant. It does not act unbecomingly. It does not seek its own. Is not provoked. Does not take into account a wrong suffered. Does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices with the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Now, Paul gives us quite the list of what love is. The first thing that he says is that in the King James, it says, charity suffereth long, or love is patient. Now, as we come to these first two attributes of love, love is patient, love is kind, or love suffereth long and is kind. Both of these are attributes of God. Both of these are words that Paul has used to refer to God and that the Bible as a whole uses to refer to God. That God is patient and that God is kind. In fact, in Romans chapter 2, verse 4, Paul says uses both of these words to describe God when he says this. Or do you think lightly of the riches of his kindness and tolerance and patience, not knowing that the kindness of God leads you to repentance? And so from in Romans chapter 2, Paul is describing God with both of these words that love is, because God is love, that God is patient and kind, that love is patient and kind. And Paul is saying that we should be patient and kind. And so he says God is patient. Now you think about all of the ways that God has been patient with us. Has God been patient with you? If you're not nodding your head, you are lying. Or you're just lazy, maybe. Or your neck muscles don't work. Want to think the best of everyone. God is patient. In fact, one commentator writes this about God's patience. He says, God's patience does not overlook anything. It simply sees farther than man. It has the end in view. That is the kind of patience that God is calling us to have. Because so often when we are in situations, when we face any kind of an opposition, when we face anything, there is an ease with which we get upset and we get frustrated and we're not patient. I'm going to make confession tonight. I was guilty of that this week. Scarlett had come downstairs and I was doing something. I don't know how your kids are. But my children don't like taking naps. And if you try and lay them down for a nap, they will find any excuse in the world to try and, you know, not take one. And so they'll just keep coming down the stairs. I forgot to give you a hug. I forgot to tell you I loved you. I forgot to get water. I forgot to go to the bathroom. I forgot, you know, I mean, just on and on and on. And so this has been going on for a little bit. And finally she comes down. And I say, Scarlett, you need to go and you need to get in bed. And she's here she comes. I don't have, she's got a little stuffed Darth Vader. And she said, I don't have my Darth Vader. And I just lost it. And I got mad and I yelled at her and I said, Scarlett, get in the bed. And I went upstairs and I got her Darth Vader and I gave it to her. And I came back and I sat down. And God started speaking to me. And oh, just how bad I felt. Because I knew that love is patient. And that I hadn't been. And so I had not been a good witness for God's love to my little girl, who I love more than anything. And so she was kind of whimpering and crying in the other room. And I got up and I went in there. And I said, Scarlett, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for not being patient with you. I'm sorry for yelling at you. Do you forgive me? And she looked at me and she nodded her head. And then I gave her a big kiss and she started smiling. God is calling us to be patient. It is so easy for us to get frustrated and to get angry and to let things get to us to where we lose our patience. It is so easy. And you know what? It's probably going to happen. I don't know if there's anybody in here that has totally mastered this and never has to apologize for getting upset about something. But I would be willing to bet probably everybody here has had to do that. If you haven't, you might want to go do it now. But what is God calling us to do? He's calling us to be patient. And he's calling us, when we're not patient, to repent. And to apologize and to make amends and to get back on the horse and keep riding and keep going. That's what God is calling us to do, to live a life of patience. And again, you know, I think there are some people that, you know, they'll see the value of patience with outsiders, but then with their own family, they're not patient. No. And in fact, one commentary I read, it said, very often we find the hardest people to be patient and kind with are the ones that we profess to love the most. And that's true. I don't know about you, but it's so much harder for me, and we're live streaming, I don't care. it's so much harder for me to be patient and kind with my brother and my sister than it is with anybody else. When they do something stupid, I just want to slap them. Because I think you should know better. We were raised in the same household, you know? But, and so often, that's the hardest people. And so, but we can't write them off and say, well, you know, it's okay to not be patient with your spouse, or it's okay to not be patient with your child. They're your child. No, that's not okay. It's not okay. It's never okay. Why? Because love is patient. And if we want to have a good witness, then we will be patient. And if we're not patient, then we will work on being patient. It will be something that we care about, becoming more patient. We won't write it off. We won't just say, well, that's not how I am. It's just people got to learn to deal with it. No, they don't. You need to learn to deal with it. God is calling us to patience. It reminds me of the parable of the unthankful servant who experienced his mercy and his patience. He experienced the master. You know, the master is willing to say, you know what, I forgive your debt. And then he goes and he meets with one of the other slaves who owes him just a small amount. And he says, pay me right now. And the guy says, I'll pay you. I just can't do it right this second. Give me some time. And he says, no, you're going to jail. What's the problem? Not only is there a lack of mercy, there's a lack of patience. He said he was going to pay him back, but he had to have it now. Patience is so valuable for us, both in big things and in small things. Whether it's an impatience that a new believer doesn't measure up like we think he should, or impatience at a restaurant where the food doesn't arrive when we think it should. When we allow impatience to control our actions, people don't see love, because love is patient. It doesn't just jump down someone's throat the first wrong, but it literally suffers long. I'm going to tell you what, when the world sees Christians and congregations who exhibit patience, they will see the love of God. And when they see the love of God, they will see Christ. But when they see impatience, they don't see the love of God. They don't see Christ. They see annoying people that they want to go away. It hurts our witness. It hurts our witness. Now, not only does he say it's patient, but he says it's kind. This is a word that has connotations of bestowing benefits or grace. In other words, one who is kind is willing to give. And so when we look at genuine Christian holy love, it extends kindness. It extends grace to people, even people who don't deserve it. You think about the Good Samaritan. That is a perfect picture of kindness. It's not owed, but it's given. Why? Because there is love in a heart. You know what I think would help us? If we Christians could just live the way Jesus said, when he said, do unto others as they deserve. He didn't say that. I know some people try and live that way, but that's not what he said. He also didn't say, do unto others as they did unto you. He said, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Now, if we could get a hold of that, you know what would happen if we could really live that way? If we could really do for others what we wish they would do for us. But most people don't live that way. Most people don't give people the benefit of the doubt. The first time something happens, they assume they had the worst of motivations. And yet, if they did the same thing and people assume the worst of motivations of them, they would be outraged. Why wouldn't you? You know, why would you think that? You know, why would you think the worst of me? Well, you've done that to a dozen other people. But too often we don't do unto others as we would have them do unto you, because we don't really think, well, what would I want done to me in this situation? How would I want that person to deal with me if the roles were reversed right now? Instead, we just get our outrage, or we get our upsetness, or we get our sadness, or our frustration, or whatever it is, and we grab it up and we just go off to the races. I'm going to take care of business. I'm going to show them how it really is. And we don't stop for a second to think, how would I want them to respond if this was me in the other seat? And yet that's what Christ calls us to do, to consider others before ourselves. That is a picture of kindness. We want people to realize when we make a mistake and not act as though we intentionally try to slight them. And yet so often when somebody else does it, we assume they intentionally tried to slight us. You can't do it. And so long as we quit asking the question, how would I want to be approached in this situation? How would I want to be detailed or dealt with? As long as we don't give others the same benefit of the doubt that we would want for ourselves, the world will see a people who live and act just like them, and it will hurt our witness. But if we can begin to truly treat others the way that we want them to treat us and show Christian kindness, holy love, then those believers will see a testimony to the power of God at work in a person's life. They will witness the love of God. And they will be drawn to him. Now, not only does he say this, he says love isn't jealous. If you go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 3, Paul says, for since there is jealousy and strife among you, are you not fleshly? And are you not walking like mere men? For when one says, I am of Paul, and another, I am of Apollos, are you not mere men? What then is Apollos? And what is Paul? Servants through whom you believed, even as the Lord gave opportunity to each one. Now, he uses the same word, this jealousy word. And he says in 1 Corinthians 3, he says, you're being jealous. And then he gets to 13 and he says, love is not jealous. In other words, he's saying you're not being loving because you're jealous and you're allowing this jealousy to drive you and to push you to do these things. Why is love not envious, not jealous? Because love considers others better than myself, and jealousy considers myself more than anybody. Jealousy is all about me and what I can get. It is born out of a self-idolatry because I think I deserve what they have. That's what jealousy is. And all of these things, when you get right down to them, they are born out of a self-idolatry. We have made idols of ourselves. That is why someone is jealous. And yet, how often do Christians and churches act with jealousy? I have heard preachers go places and preach at a place, and as they're shaking hands at the door, in fact, I know of a preacher who had a preacher come, they preached, they went and stood at the door, and the preacher that I know was over there with them, and they heard somebody say, "Oh, I wish you were our preacher." Jealousy, envy. Instead of thankfulness that we have a preacher, jealousy for what someone else has. Oh, if we only had that preacher, then we'd really grow. No, so long as you're in the congregation, you ain't growing nothing. You're just going to keep going down, 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 down. And yet so often, you know, churches act like they can't. Here's one of the things. I know we're getting close to the end. You know, you may have noticed the past week or two, I just don't care anymore. One time, Sister Sarah told me this. She told me that she got to a place one time where she had been preaching for a number of years. And she was just so frustrated and so upset and just didn't know what to do. And God finally told her, he said, "Look, you work for me." So she went to church the next Sunday and she said, "Look, I work for God. I don't care what you think. I don't care what you do. As long as I'm here, I'm going to preach. It is what it is." And that's what she's done ever since. Well, that's kind of how I feel. It is what it is. But one thing that I've noticed this whole, actually, I noticed it on Wednesday morning after the campaign, after the election, all that was over. And here's what I noticed. You know, before Donald Trump won, the way Hillary Clinton talked, and I'm not making a judgment on either one of them, okay? I don't like either one of them. Before, if you would have listened to the way Hillary Clinton talked about Donald Trump, if Donald Trump won, it was going to be World War III. I mean, the sky was going to fall. The ground was probably going to open up below us and swallow us whole if he won. And then he won. And then she gets on and is like, "Well, we got to give him a chance." Okay. Now, hold on. Here's the thing. If I really believed that someone was going to lead to World War III and there were, you know, and just everything was going to fall apart and the ground was going to swallow us whole, you know, I have a hard time thinking. If I really, really, genuinely believe it, I have a hard time thinking, "Well, we got to give him a chance. It is what it is." You know what I'm saying? I mean, it's like all of a sudden, the next day, everything just kind of went. And then I don't know if you saw, but Barack Obama and Donald Trump had their meeting together. And they come out and they sit next to each other and they just look so friendly and they're just talking to one another like they're best friends. I mean, and Donald Trump is saying, "Yeah, you know, I really enjoyed it. We could have talked for another hour and a half." And I'm like, "What?" Both of you, you know, talked about the other like you were Satan incarnate. And now you're just hanging out, having a good time. And here's, you know, as I was watching that and I was just thinking about that, this is the sort of the conclusion that I came to, or the thought that came to me. During campaign mode, we got to win. So the rhetoric, we got to amp it up to 2,000 degrees, right? It's worst case scenario. But once the election has passed, and it is what it is, whether you like it or not, it is what it is. It's going to be here. You can't do anything about it. You can't change it. Everybody just has, they realize, "Well, we can't do anything about it, so might as well get used to it." And that's what happens. And as I was thinking about that, I thought, you know, there are a lot of Christians and church people who live in campaign mode. They've got the doomsday message up 110%. Oh, you know, it's like anybody who doesn't believe just like me, you might as well just jump on the bandwagon and the highway to hell, because that's straight where they're leading you. But I'm telling you what, there is going to come a day when the election is over spiritually, and heaven is going to be populated by everyone who repented, confessed, believed, and had that love. And it's not going to matter. All these different things, we're all going to look like Barack Obama and Donald Trump sitting down and having a nice conversation together. because the campaign will be over. But you know what would be nice? Is if we could stop the campaign right now. And not have such a negative attitude about everybody that's any bit, you know, the least bit different than us. Because again, what does the world need to see? They need to see Christians who have a holy love that is not jealous. That doesn't envy. Why? And you know what? As Christians, why should we be jealous? Why should we be envious? We have a God who provides us with everything that we need. Why should we be jealous? That's what the world needs to see. He goes on, he says, not only is love not jealous, but he says it doesn't brag. And it's not arrogant. Again, when you look at the Corinthians, they had a boastful spirit. They had a bragging spirit. And Paul warns them that bragging and boasting and being proud, it is never born out of love. That's why he says this in chapter 4. He says, now these things, brethren, I have figuratively applied to myself and Apollos for your sakes, so that in us you may learn not to exceed what is written, so that no one of you will become arrogant in belief of one against the other. For who regards you as superior? What do you have that you did not receive? And if you did receive it, why do you boast as if you had not received it? What is Paul saying? He's saying you have nothing to boast about. Earlier in the letter, he says this. But by his doing, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, so that just as it is written, let him who boasts, boast in the Lord. Paul is very clear that we have nothing to be arrogant about. We have nothing to boast about. We have done nothing. And yet we boast and brag as if we are something. You know, here we go. I'm going to get a little controversial again. I don't care, though. I see it in sports. You ever see people boast about sports? How little sense does that make? Well, we won. You won. What practices were you at? Which plays were you involved in? And what really gets me, and this is where I'm really going to get in trouble. You might just, you know, go ahead and give me my letter right now. Go ahead and start writing it, Brother Tony. I here's something I've never understood. You know, it's like we get so invested in a college sports team that we didn't even attend the college. Okay. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it. Don't get me wrong. But what I'm saying is when we get so invested in it, and we start boasting about, oh, we're the best. We're the best. We're the champions. We're the Super Bowl champs. We're this. We're that. No, you are nothing. You had nothing to do with that win. Nothing. You were not involved in it at all. At no step in the process of them winning did you play any part. Not a single bit. If you didn't exist, they would still have, the same thing would have happened. You did nothing. So why do you boast, Paul says? You've done nothing. And yet we get proud over the stupidest things. We get boastful and arrogant about these things that we had nothing to do with. No, don't misunderstand me. I don't know how the Cowboys are doing right now. They were losing when I came in here. But what I'm saying is that it's when we get so invested in these things that we had nothing to do with. We start boasting about these things we had nothing to do with. We become arrogant about these things that we had nothing to do with. And there's nothing wrong with sports. That's not what I'm saying. There's nothing wrong with any of those things. All I'm saying is that when we become proud, it's about self. It's not about love. There are people who have genuinely been hurt because of sports talk. And I'm going to tell you what. If that happens in the church, it is a sad, sad day. Because that means nothing. It's worthless in eternity. You know, it's all going to come to an end. It's all going to come to an end. We have nothing to boast about, Paul says. So he says, love does not boast. It doesn't brag. It's not arrogant. And again, what would happen if the world saw a church and saw Christians who were always as humble as Jesus? You find me an example in the Gospels where Jesus bragged. When he came out of the tomb, did he say, hey guys, you know what? You know, I've got still some more things to teach you. But before that, I got to go see those Pharisees and tell them, I told you so. No. Why? Because Jesus was always humble. He was not worried about getting the last word. He was not worried about always being right, even though he was. And even though if there was any man who deserved to boast, it was him, and he didn't. And so often we walk around boasting about things we have nothing to do with, thinking we are justified. No, we're not. We're not. Boasting is not of God. But if the world, again, when we boast, when we brag, when we're arrogant, we are hurting our witness. That's all we're doing, is we're hurting our witness, because boasting and bragging and arrogance do not come from the love of God. And so when people see that, they don't see Christ, they see you. But if they see humility and they see a willingness to always consider yourself last, they see the love of God. And if they see the love of God, they see Christ. And if they see Christ, they will be drawn to Christ. It's our best witness. Not only does he say that, I'm almost done, don't worry, I'm not going to do them all. He says that love does not act unbecomingly. Now, the church at Corinth was a church that had a reputation for acting unbecomingly. This is a word that means shamefully. This is the church where there was a man who was sleeping with his father's wife. This is a church where Paul describes the act of the women prophesying without their heads covering was a shameful act. This is a church where you had another reference that Paul has to acting shamefully towards his betrothed virgin. There, when we look at the way they were taking communion, Brother Tony, I think, mentioned it this morning about them coming drunk and things. That was a shameful thing. This was a church that was very shameful. And what Paul says is love does not act shamefully. It doesn't act unbecomingly. It doesn't act in a way that brings shame to the name of Christ. And when Christians and churches do shameful things, they act in ways that hide Christ and ultimately push people away from the gospel. And you know what? It doesn't matter what congregation they go to. When a Christian, when someone who claims the name of Christ acts shamefully, it hurts us all. You know, when a few years ago there was a church not too far from here that, where the pastor got caught involved in pornography. Now, two thoughts on that. The first one is, that doesn't just shame that church. It shames all who bear the name Christ. That's why we have to be so careful about the way that we act and the way that we live. But also, we shouldn't say, oh, a good thing I don't go to that church. Why? Because love does not boast. Love is not arrogant. And so the minute you start saying, oh, well, you know, God, good thing we're not like them. Sure glad that we've got a pastor that's not like that. That arrogance starts to come. You know what happens when arrogance starts to come? The Bible tells us that God gives grace to the humble, but he opposes the proud. When we get proud, this is the other thing about pride. When we get proud, you know what happens? God opposes us. When we get proud, we set ourselves in opposition to God Almighty. And that's why the Bible says that pride goeth before the fall. Because when we get proud, you better believe that is going to be the moment in which our downfall has been written. When we see a Christian act unbecomingly, it's not an opportunity to thank God I'm not like them. It's an opportunity to pray for their soul and to pray for those that have seen that and been a witness to that, that God would soften their hearts. He goes on, he says, love doesn't seek his own. Again, this is something that we see throughout all of this. Love is outward focused. Pride and idolatry are inward focused. And so Christ sets us an example of seeking the good of everyone else first and ourselves last. And this is genuine Christian love. It isn't first concerned with myself and my safety and my comfort. It is concerned first and foremost with the kingdom. And this is how, as we talked about last week, Christians can undergo persecution, because true love is not focused on self. It's focused on others and it's focused on God. When the world sees a Christianity that is so focused on satisfying and protecting itself to the detriment of others, they don't see the mark of love and they don't see Christ. But when they see a people who are so outward focused and focused on how they can serve and love others, that is when they see the mark of love. And that's when they see Christ. Now he goes on, he says, it's not easily provoked. Think of how easily some people are provoked. This goes into the love is patient thing. You know, one little slight and some people fly off the handle. And yet you think about all that Christ endured, all that he went through, and yet he was like a sheep led to the slaughter. Quiet, patient, humble. Being easily provoked is rooted in that proud spirit, because it just amplifies everything that's done to me. You know, it was done to me. So I deserve to lash out. I deserve to get angry. No, you don't. No, you don't. If you did the same thing to somebody else, you wouldn't want somebody else flying off the handle. So again, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. What does the world see in our lives? Do they see people who are easily provoked, who get angry at the littlest thing? Or do they see people who, in the face of adversity, even if that adversity is having to go through the Wendy's drive-thru 3 times because they get your order wrong every time? That is, you know, that matters. You know, we can write things like that off, but those things matter because those people see that. And they need to see the mark of love, because in the mark of love, they will see Christ. Now, not only that, but he says it doesn't take into account a wrong suffered. Again, you know, we know the song, count your blessings, name them one by one. It's not count your injuries, name them one by one. Count the wrongs that people have done to you, name them one by one. There's a lot of people like to do that instead. They'd prefer to count all their problems and all the different ways people have wronged them, all the different situations where people haven't loved them like they should, and all the ways that the pastor didn't listen to them when he should have, and on and on and on and on and on. But you know what, love? It doesn't keep a record of wrongs. That's why Jesus told the disciples that you forgive someone 70 times 7 times. Why? How many times have we offended God in our lives? How many times in our lives have we ignored his leading? Have we just outright rejected him? Did we rebel against him? How many times did we sin? You look at your whole life. You think about all the ways that we've wronged God in the past. I don't care if you've been saved 30 years. You look at all the ways. It does not compare to what people have done to you. Because he created us. He made us. We were his children. And he made us to love him. People are people. And they're going to offend you. And they're going to upset you. And that's the way that it is. And we don't keep records. Because if you do, you will drive yourself insane. Instead, you know what you do? This is the advice that I tell Heather. I may have told you before. There are times when Heather will say, you know, just all kinds, you know, just situations, people, being people. And I'll say, Heather, do you know how that person is? And she'll say, yeah. So would you expect differently? Well, no. Then why are you surprised? You know what? If somebody acts a certain way and they do something, and they've done it 100 times in the past, it's time maybe for you to realize they're just going to keep doing it. And the best thing to do is pray for them. Because they're not all of a sudden going to, you know, I mean, unless God just does a mighty work, they're not going to just all of a sudden quit acting the same way they've always acted. That doesn't give us a reason to start counting the wrongs. Instead, we just need to recognize it is what it is. People are people. And you know what? The world needs to see a Christianity that so empowers people that they're not worried about how many times they were wronged. Instead, they just love. And they love no matter what. They love no matter what the opposition, no matter what the anger, no matter what the upset situation is. No, he goes on and he says this. He says, it does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but it rejoices with the truth. I would encourage you to ask yourself the question, what have I been rejoicing in? What have I been rejoicing in? And then he says this, and I've always loved this verse 7. He says that love bears all things, that it believes all things, that it hopes all things, that endures all things. Now, this doesn't mean that, you know, that Christianity leads us to all be just gullible. You know, that we believe everything that comes our way. But it does mean this. This is what I want to close with. That there is no limit to our faith in God. And to our faith even that God can work in the worst of people. There is no limit to that. So it doesn't matter how bad that person is, doesn't matter how messed up they are, I'm always going to have faith that God, I know you can get to them and you can convict them and you can save them. Love believes all things. It has that kind of a faith. It doesn't write people off. It believes all things. It bears all things. It hopes all things. There is no limit to our hope. There is no limit to it because we have a God who, at the beginning of this service, like I said, we have a God who's done amazing things, and he's still able to do them. And as a result, there's no limit to the hope we have in him. And there is no limit to what we can endure because he is empowering us and he is guiding us and he is giving us the strength that we need, and he will carry us through because he's just that good. Like I said, you know, I just thought the message this morning was so needed, so good. And I want us to really think about sort of the flip side of not only the unity and us being one, but that love is our primary witness. And that if we're going to win the world, we're not going to win them. I all these things have their place, but we're not going to win them through tracks or through, you know, all these things. You know why we're going to win them? We're going to win them through love. We're going to win them by going out and meeting people and loving them and showing the love of Christ and showing them how God has transformed us, and them saying, you know what? I want to experience the kind of love that they've experienced. That's how we're going to win the world. That's how we're going to win souls. It's going to happen through one-on-one going out and loving people. As Jesus said, they will know you are my disciples by the love that you have for one another.